continuing our study, we're kind of getting near the end of our study of Nehemiah, the life and character of that great Old Testament character, or a person. We use the term character sometimes. We think it's a fiction novel, but a person who lived in those times that encourages us and shows us how we can be better believers. Now, if you remember, we heard last week and throughout the couple of weeks that as they heard God's word, the people in Israel got excited about it. They wanted to know more about it. They also saw at that moment how God's word applied to them. And that during last week's sermon, we talked about them celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles. And that's when they lived in shacks. They looked back on how God has brought them to where they are now. God wanted them to be reminded of how their ancestors were. They lived in tents and stuff. They didn't have all the blessings that these folks have now. And sometimes it's a good lesson for us as well to realize how many blessings we have compared to maybe what a generation or two had before us. Things that we take for granted. And even way back to the first century church, how we're so blessed compared to what they have, at least materially. They were also encouraged not to rely on those blessings, but to trust God as He's the provider of all that we need. We mentioned, I think, before that sometimes we refer to our job as providing. Actually, God is the provider, and He does that through job and whatever else, however else He deems fit. A lot of times, if you studied Old Testament history, every time Israel got a good blessing and they were, you know, going pretty good, what happened? They forgot about God, right? And they kind of fell away. And it took God to take everything away from them again to get their attention. We don't want that to happen with us. Now, the timeline we mentioned last week, you'll see a progression through the month of October for them. October 2nd, the wall was completed. October 4th and 5th, they celebrated Rosh Hashanah, or their new year. October 8th, they started the time of teaching. Ezra came up on the 8th and started teaching them. The 9th, just the leaders came back and they got in more in depth of God's word. And when they studied that, they found out things that would apply to them at that moment that they didn't know about over the course of history. They forgot about what the Old Testament said. They saw this Feast of Tabernacles. They realized it was coming up, so they wanted to do that. October 12th was the Day of Atonement, and then after that was the Feast of Tabernacles that they celebrated. It lasted about 8 days. When that was done, now we're at about October 24th when that feast was done. So that picks us up at the beginning of chapter 9. And chapter 9 says this in verse 1, says, on October 31st, the people returned for another observance. This time they fasted and dressed in sackcloth and sprinkled dust on their heads. Now, if you remember the Feast of Tabernacles, they were celebrating, eating great food, just having a great time. And during that time, they were remembering God's blessings, but also they had just finished studying God's word in depth. The first part, they were able to celebrate the goodness of God. Now, once they realized what God's word said and how it applied to them, what happened? They realized how sinful they as a nation have been and they as a people are. So what happened was they realized that, and they said they dressed in sackcloth and ashes. And if you remember all throughout the Bible, every time that's mentioned, that's a time where they repented of their sin. They were sorry for it. They did all these things in order to show God that they were in repentance of it. And that kind of ties into what I mentioned earlier. As we worship and as we spend time in God's word, whether it's in this setting or in your classroom setting or in your personal devotions, what usually happens is God reveals to you through His word or through the time of worship, first, how good He is, which is what they celebrated a week ago, and it also shows us all of our shortfalls as well. It shows us the things that we're lacking in, things that we need to improve on, and maybe even things that we've just been doing this wrong. And so when that happens, what does it do? It causes us to want to get right and repent and do it better. Now, the word says in Romans 8:1 that there's now, therefore, no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. That means if you're a believer, all your past sins are forgiven. Now, how many of us have experienced guilt and condemnation from those past sins after you've been saved? We all look back, really. And we look back and just think, man, how can I have been so dumb or hard or bad or wicked? But the good thing is, they're all forgiven. All forgiven. The question is, how many of us, after we've been saved, continue to do bad and wicked things? Sometimes, right? Things that were in our life that, you know, you're still involved in those kind of things, but you really want to get out of them. The more you stand away from God, the greater those things become. The more you spend time with God and in worship, the more you realize that those things have to go. And so as Israel spent that time studying God's word and in celebrating and enjoying how good God was, the second part of that also comes into effect. You want to get better. You want to get rid of the things in your life that you know are holding you back, and that's where they were. And I think if we're honest with ourselves, what is happening as we worship is we really realize how sinful we as a people are. How many felt that way? That's not our nature, because we've been redeemed. But I told the teens this morning, left to ourselves, we will sin. And the phrase you've all heard before is, I might get it right, we're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we are sinners by nature. And so what these folks were doing is they realized all their mistakes throughout history up to even where they are now. So even though God had blessed them, they rejoiced, they started celebrating God's word, the next thing was, okay, there's things in our lives we need to get rid of and things that need to change. So they fasted, they dressed in burlap or sackcloth and ashes, and it was a symbol of intense mourning and time of repentance before God. So now we come to verse 2. It says, those of Israelite descent separated themselves from all foreigners as they confessed their own sins and the sins of their ancestors. What we're going to see here is there's three parts of their repentance that goes on. The first thing they did was they separated themselves from the things they knew were causing them issues. And if you remember way back when the law was given, God says, do not intermarry, stay within Israel. Don't marry outside the faith. And so obviously that's what they were doing. They were marrying all outside of different tribes. And if you read the book of Ezra, now this was tough. Ezra, which is happening at the same time roughly that this is happening, part of their repentance was that they were to send their foreign wives and kids away. Send them out. Now that seems kind of weird for us today that we wouldn't ever do that. But God says, and Ezra said, okay, if you want to really follow God, send those foreign wives that you never should have married away with those kids. Wow. And we think of that now. That's ridiculous. However, what in your life do you hold on to that's valuable to you that if God says get rid of it now, would you get rid of now? The Word of God should allow us to discover what we need to do to get to the next level. What do we need to do to progress as believers? When we see how sinful we are and how much we really have sinned, only then can we realize how good God has been to us. Think about your past sinful life, the where we are now. We're all not perfect. We all sin in various areas. But the song we sang, your love never fails, never gives up, it never walks out on me. No matter what we do now, what we've done then, what we are going to do in the future, that song is true. God's love never for us fails. And when we see how good that is, what's the Bible say? The goodness of God leads us to repentance, right? When we see how good God is to us, we want to become better believers. Verses 3 and 4, it says, the book of the law of the Lord was read aloud to them for 3 hours. Then for 3 more hours, they took turns confessing their sins and worshiping the Lord their God. Some of the Levites were standing on the chairs crying out to the Lord their God. Now, I'm not sure if some of you may have experienced this, but years ago, church services used to last long time, long time. And in fact, I know some that still do. They'll worship, just the music part of the service will last an hour, hour and a half. And then they spend time at the altar praying for about another hour. A friend of mine pastors a church in West Virginia. This is their normal week. They come in around 9, they leave around 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon. That's how long their services are. That's how long services used to be in Pentecostal. And if you go to other countries, today, that's how long their services are. I think us in America just have shrunk that down a little bit to make it about 90 minutes. And we think that God stops moving around noon. When lunch is started, God says, okay, I'm done. It's not really how it works. And I think we all know that, and we are willing to stay and do what God wants us to do regardless of how long it takes. But these folks stood for 3 hours to hear the sermon and study God's word, and then after that, 3 more hours to confess their sins. Now, I'm going to combine chapters 9 and 10 and kind of gloss over that for a moment. But now they're at a 6-hour service. And what God was doing was God was showing them, if you read 9 and 10, all they were confessing of all the things that their ancestors did, bringing them right up to current where they are today. And they were just listing them one by one by one and repenting of them. And they were truly sorrowful for what not only they did, but their ancestors did. The rest of the chapter of 9 leads them in a prayer that gives a brief history. Now, if you read your Old Testament, how many times do you see, and even in the New Testament, every time someone starts to preach or every time someone starts to pray, they're basically giving an entire recount of what has happened up to that point. And you read it, and you read it again, and then you read it again, different counts in the Bible. That is to remind us of what God has blessed them with, plus what they walked away from. It talks about how many times as a country they walked away from God. And God always kept pursuing them. Think about ourselves. How many times have we not maybe totally walked away from God, but kind of ignored his goodness and ignored his faithfulness? How many times have we trusted him? After we trusted him, have we failed him? You know, every time I read about Israel, I look at them and say, how can you guys keep making the same mistake? And then every time I say that, God says, right, how many times can you make the same mistake? And it may not be total apostasy like Israel did, but we all have those things in our life that we keep going over and doing that we know we shouldn't do until finally God allows us to come to that point where we get rid of it. And I was reading this entire chapter thinking to myself, this is kind of a snapshot of our country, is it not? Way back a couple hundred years ago, founded basically on Christian values and principles. Debatable as to who was believer and who was not, but I think most of us agree, if you look at the writings, we had Christian principles involved in the founding of this country. And look what's happened over the years. We're becoming just like Old Testament Israel. We're walking away from God's blessing and going into an area that we shouldn't be in. As a nation, every time I turn the news on, I see one more thing that 10 years ago you'd have thought would never have happened. So the people, after they review their history as a nation and how far they've fallen away from God, they read the word, what happens? They commit themselves to come back to God. We're not going to be like our ancestors. We're going to make a commitment now, and we're going to do it right. And that commitment involves 3 different areas of their life in general. 9:38 says, and they're basically making the promise, it says, yet in spite of all this, we are making a solemn promise and putting it in writing. On this sealed document are the names of our princes, Levites, and priests. It tells who the leaders are, and the leaders are committed to making this right before God. And then it talks about the people who are going to follow the leaders to do that. Now we're going to skip all the way back, or all the way ahead to chapter 10, verse 28. It says, the rest of the people, the priests, Levite, gatekeepers, singers, temple servants, and all who had separated themselves from the pagan people of the land in order to serve God, who were old enough to understand, now all heartily bound themselves with an oath. They vowed to accept the curse of God if they failed to obey the law as issued by the servant Moses. They solemnly promised to carefully follow all the commands, laws, and regulations of the Lord, their Lord. The people at that point were vowing to make a new start, a new beginning. The past was behind them. They can't change that, just like we can't change what's happened in our past. But we can make a vow to go on from this point on. A man by the name of Alexander White says this. He says, the victorious Christian life is a series of new beginnings. I thought about that. How many of us have made new beginnings as believers after we've been believers? Things that we realize we should do or shouldn't do, and we commit to change them and move on from there. And then as time goes by, either we don't fulfill them or we fulfill them and see other things. We always are continuing to make new beginnings, whether that's in our choices or in what's happening in our lives. As you're a teenager, you're making choices then. As a married, young married couple, now you're making different choices, a new different beginning. When your kids get a little bit older, you now make a new beginning. You're doing different things. As your kids leave the house, you're now making a new choice, a new beginning. No matter where we are today, whether we're on fire for God or whether we realize we need to make a choice or make a difference, every day can be a new beginning. What's the Bible say? Peter said, how many times should I forgive that person? What, 70 times 7? Or 7 times 7? Or 7 times? And then Jesus says, no, I'm telling you 70 times 7, which is an idiom for as many as it takes. So that tells me that God, as many as it takes for us to make a new start, God's waiting to hear it. What was our tagline for the church when we first started? Church of New Beginnings, right? We all have new beginnings. We all can make a new start. Whether it's day to day, week to week, month to month, we can all make a new start. You can't let the past dictate where you're going to go now. Psalm 37:23 says, the steps of the godly are directed by the Lord. He delights in every detail of their lives. Though they stumble, they will not fall, for the Lord holds them by his hand. How many are thankful for that? I remember when my kids were little, and you'd be walking across the street, you're holding their hand, and what happens? Your kids trip, right? And they go to fall, but since you're holding their hand, they don't hit the pavement. They stumble and you're kind of holding them up by their hand. That's the image you get from God. We can be walking our daily Christian life and sin, mess up, do something wrong, and we're tripping and we're stumbling like the little child is. But who's holding you from falling completely? Man, how many times has God held us while we are on our way to the ground? The Lord holds them by his hand. He's holding us. We're not holding onto him. If you're walking with your little child, you're holding their hand. They're not holding onto you. So now the Jewish people felt bad for the nation sinning and as their own as well. They committed to following God, receiving his blessings. And the real proof is now what happens next in their lives. What are they going to do? There's one thing to trust God and say, I'm saved, I love Jesus. The next thing is, are we going to do what we know there is to do? How many of us either have been this person or know folks who they come to the altar and they're crying and they're trusting God and they walk out, they're going to believe God, and on Monday morning, they go back to exactly the way they were before they came to church. They promise God they're going to do all these great things, and then all of a sudden they wake up the next day and they slide back into how they used to be. Once you trust God and you do that, there are steps we need to take to commit to doing that. There are going to be evidence in your lives that shows your desire to follow God is sincere and not just words. And they promise to follow God even if it meant hardship to them. Nehemiah 10:30 says, we promise not to let our daughters marry the pagan people of the land, nor to let our sons marry their daughters. We further promise that if the people of the land should bring any merchandise or grain to be sold on the Sabbath or any other holy day, we will refuse to buy it. And we promise not to do any work on the seventh year and to cancel the debts owed to us by other Jews. Sacrifice is a part of being a Christian. How many know that? Sometimes we want to obey God's word until it tells us to do something we don't want to do. or maybe uncomfortable to us, or maybe will cost us to do it. If we're truly thankful to God for his blessings, we will be eager to do the things he wants us to do. The first thing is they were not to marry outside their faith. That same principle applies today. We are not to be unequally yoked. It means as Christians, we can't marry someone or actually be in any kind of a steady, long-term relationship with someone who's not. That could be business, that could be marriage. Somewhere where you are partnered together with someone who's not a believer. Missionary dating is not a biblical principle. How many know that? You can't date someone and hope that they'll get saved. Because all along the lines, they'll say, when we get married, I promise to go to church with you. When we get married, I promise to do this stuff. I guarantee you, it's not going to happen. They also weren't allowed to do work or make money at certain times because they were set apart for God. Seventh year, 50th year, seventh day of the week. God says, don't work. I know you can make money on that day. Trust me that I will provide what you need if you're obedient to me. And all throughout Israel's history, they failed at every one of those things. The seventh year, don't plant any crops. Now we know scientifically today why that is, how you rotate crops and stuff. But back then God says, just don't plant them. Don't plant them. Trust me to provide you in the sixth year everything you're going to need for the seventh. 50th year, forgive all debts. Wow. It was going to be a struggle for them to do that. Because think about us. In our natural state, that seems illogical. Why can't I work on the seventh day, make better income for my family? Why can't I do these things for God? Why can't I work on the seventh year and plant stuff and have more for, and we'll give it to the poor? And in the 50th year, well, if I forgive debts, that's going to deny my family things. God told them he would provide enough to cover all those things if they trusted him to do it. There are times when God calls us to not do things in order for us to see if we're going to believe him. Now, I'm gonna get one of these days a soapbox. I'm not sure what they are. Is it like a cardboard box? They're all plastic now. You can't get a soapbox. But I'm going to pull it out for a minute. And I'm going to probably step on someone's toes, and you may not agree with me. And that's okay. Sunday is not a day to get caught up in the things we miss doing throughout the week. It's not a day that you can, I can sleep in. Now, I'm saying that to people who are here. I'm doing the same thing I used to yelp my pastor for. You're preaching to the people that are here. Preach to the people that aren't here. But the point is, all the things that we didn't get done throughout the week, Sunday's not the day to do them. Because I believe that Sunday is the same day, same principle as tithing. You get more done in less time if you're obedient. Just as if you have more income at the end of the month if you're faithful in tithing than if you didn't tithe. I don't know how that works. I don't know how it works, but it does. And I believe that the hour and a half or so that we give God on Sunday morning, God will make up the remainder of the day to do. God says, don't work on the seventh day. Now that we know that's Saturday. Seventh year, 50th year. All those were things not to deny people, but to see if they trusted him. And as they trusted him, God provided for them. If you look at Joshua's time, man, everything that they did that was right, God has poured his blessing upon them. Deuteronomy tells all the blessings that God would give them if they were obedient. And yet, in spite of all that, they didn't believe it. They thought they could do it their own way. Nehemiah 10:32 says, in addition, we promise to obey the command to pay the temple tax of an eighth of an ounce of silver so that there'll be enough money to care for the temple of our God. This will provide for the bread of presence, from the regular grain offerings and burnt offerings, for the offerings on the Sabbath, the new moon celebrations, and the annual festivals, for the holy offerings, and for the sin offerings to make atonement for Israel. It will also provide other items necessary for the work of the temple of our God." The first choice they made was a choice in lifestyle and obedience. The second choice was obedience in giving. God's work has always been supported by God's people from back at the beginning. Giving is the only thing that God tells us to test him on. Right? Malachi 3:8, it says, "Should people cheat God? Yet you have cheated me. But you ask, what do you mean? When did we ever cheat you?" God says, "You have cheated me out of the tithes and offerings due to me. You are under a curse, for your whole nation has been cheating me. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord Almighty, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in." I like this phrase, New Living Translation. "Try it. Let me prove it to you." Does God need, or did God need their money? Does God need our money? No. Obviously, God can provide anything and everything they need for the temple, for this church, but he wants us to be involved in the process. He wants us to trust him. It allows us and these guys to know that they are a necessary part of God's kingdom. If God just provided everything they needed and didn't have to do anything, didn't have to work or give or anything, what would happen to them? Think about your kids. If you gave them everything they wanted and needed at the time they asked you for it, what happens? They become spoiled, do they not? And they become expecting. And eventually they become dependent. God does not want any of that for any of us. So God says, "I want you to be actively involved. I want you to give, to be a part of what we're doing in this temple. I want you to claim ownership of this temple. This is God's temple, but it's yours. You support it. It's part of your life." So we have lifestyle and choices. We have obedience and giving. And now we have obedience in working in God's kingdom. Verse 34 says, "We have cast sacred lots to determine when, at regular times each year, the families of the priests, Levites, and the common people should bring wood to God's temple to be burned on the altar of our Lord our God as required by the law." The people all had to work in maintaining what God was doing in the country. It wasn't just the priests and Levites, it was the common people as well. Everyone was important in the Jewish nation. Everyone had a part to play for them, not just the leaders. Everyone was involved. God wanted them to experience the ownership in their land, that they owned what they were doing. When people take ownership of something, what happens? They do their best to support it, do they not? What's the difference between a housing project and a residence? Generally, the people, and this is just a generality, since you don't own it, you don't take care of it as well as someone who does own it. You find that to be the case? Not always, generalities. If you own it, you take possession of it. It's yours. You take pride in what you do your best to maintain it. You have ownership in it. God wanted the nation of Israel to have ownership in the land and the temple that they had. It was theirs. And if they took ownership in it, they would take pride in doing their work. They would take pride in bringing the wood. They would take pride in bringing the tithes. They would take pride in whatever it was God had them to do because it was their temple. It was their country's temple. That's the pride of ownership. God wanted them to take pride in ownership. Everyone, from that point on until today, God needs us, or God has chosen to use us to further his kingdom. Everyone has a part to play. Just like Israel, everyone was important to what God was doing then, and everyone is important to what God is doing today. Everyone should take pride in ownership of their church. Our old pastor used to drill this into our head all the time. He would say, if you see something in the parking lot, pick it up. Don't wait for somebody else to get it. You pick it up. Bring it to the garbage can. This is your church. Pick it up. If you see something that needs to be done, don't tell someone. Do it. Just go do it. This is our church. We should take pride in ownership. And I think we do for the most part. We should want our church to be the best that it can be and be willing to do what it takes to make it that way. God wanted Israel to take a part in what they had and to take pride in their ownership, their land that God had given them, that God had blessed them with. That, man, this is something that God gave us. We want to do our best to maintain it, and we're all involved in doing that. Notice that it says not only the leaders, but the common people. Now, we don't have that today. We don't have that type of caste system. We're all a part of God's economy. We're all a part of what God is doing. And the work of God only progresses as far as all of us are involved in doing it. Now, the remaining verses talk about how they were to bring a tithe of all the, you know, everything they had. And they were repeating this not just to say the words. Think about what they did. They found God's word. They started reading it. They saw the blessings that God promised them if they were obedient. They weren't experiencing those yet. So what they did is they started to apply what they learned in expectation of what the blessings would be. We as believers are the same way, or should be the same way. We used to say for a long time, come expecting the church for God to do something. Well, that could be said of any area of our life that we are obedient in. I want to see how God does miracles. So I'm going to be my best to not interfere with that and do whatever I can do so that God says, okay, here's the blessing. If it's tithing, if it's working, if it's whatever it is, I want to be obedient and allow God to use me for whatever he wants to use me for. And then you know what? That's the blessing. And you know what that's called? That's called revival. When you see what God's word says, you're convicted by it, you're excited to get involved, to see the next step that God's going to do, and what happens is that's contagious. You know, they talk about church revival. Church revival only happens because individuals are revived in the church. The more I read God's word, the more I want to put it into practice, the more I want to see something happen, expecting something to happen because God says it's going to happen. Whether we trust him or not really dictates what we're going to do for the future. Do we believe that God is going to do it? You know, when we come every Sunday, hopefully we don't come because it's Sunday and we have to be in church. My expectation is, what is God going to do today? How can God change something or someone's life or situation today? Is someone going to be saved today? Is God going to move by his spirit to do something awesome today? Or maybe we just leave all feeling that we've been in the presence of God. We come because God says, I'm here, and I'm ready to pour out blessings upon you. If you're not here, you're going to miss it. I want God to do great things. The same thing applies to your personal devotional life. And we were at this point many times, and I don't want to nag on tithing, but God promised to do it. And so even though I tried to find scriptures to get out of it, and you know, maybe God didn't apply it to me, we did it. And God provided. Miraculously. It wasn't checks in the mail. It was things that allowed us to continue to pay the bills, to continue to move on and continue. The best part of it was we saw the miracle happen, that God did it. Healing. We prayed and we believed for a healing. Lauren was healed. That's what I'm talking about. It's not just knowledge up here. It's practical things that happen in your life as a result of trusting God. And the more we read this book, the more we see how God interacts with people. And he does miraculous things. He interjects into your life, into your family. You see things in your family. You see things at work. You see things in church that you know God had a hand in. And the more that we see that, the more we should be excited to see the next thing. Because the Bible says, it never stops. Behold, I'm going to do a new thing. So what happened yesterday could be different tomorrow. But the point is, God never stops. The Bible says, Jesus says, I work and my Father works. That word work is a continuing verb. It never stops. We want to commit not only to follow God's word, but we want to do it because we want to see God move. Is that not what we want? You go to, you know, third world nations and missions projects where they have nothing. And they, as we saw the video about the Chinese folks receiving their Bibles for the first time, they are excited because they want to see what God's word says about their life and how they can apply that to their life to see miraculous things happen. And I've seen a lot of stuff happen that were, you know, bona fide miracles. God moving in a powerful way, things changing that could never be changed. People getting saved that you never thought would get saved. People getting healed all over the place. Always know, but you don't know when it's going to happen. That's the kind of faith, that's the kind of church that we want to be. Not just coming to read some old book about history. We want to see how this book is alive and applies to me today. When I pray, do I pray really believing that this is true? And I can tell you, and you've probably all experienced it, when you don't pray, what happens? You begin to rely on yourself, what you can do, what you can't do. And that's your limitations. But when you pray and really seek God's face and you come upon those things that are impossible, that's when you really need God to intervene, and that's when you want to see God move. And when he does, it should build your faith and make you excited for what is happening next. I shared this story before, but I'm going to share it again. We'll close with this. Many years ago at our old church, our pastor was really convinced. We were trying to get a new property for our church and build it, make a bigger church. And he was really convinced to buy this one. It was about 100 acres. Now, at the time, it was utility deprived. It had no utilities on it, so which means you couldn't build. But the township promised us they're going to run utilities out to that property. And so he was convinced that we were buying it, and we spent, it was relatively inexpensive, $500,000 for the property, per 100 acres. And so we buy this property, and township says, nah, we're not going to run utilities out. So now we're stuck, 100 acres of unusable land. And so they keep this land for a while, and everyone thinks it was a boondoggle mistake. Years later, after I've left, somebody was building a development on the other side, and we sold some of our land or leased it to them. And on the property that we had, as they were building, they drilled and they found oil on the property. And I don't know how long it's been going on, but they were receiving a check for many thousands of dollars every month for the oil that we were shipping out to this company. Who'd have thunk it? And that income was more than able to pay for the property as well as pay for any additions they wanted to do for the church. That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. God can do anything. At the time, it seemed impossible. What a waste of money. What a waste of time. What are we doing? But he was convinced, and we were all, okay. That's the stuff I'm talking about. When it's something you look at, you feel God's leading you to do, and you look at it and say, that is No way. There is no way that can happen. But okay, God, if you're involved in this, I'm going to step out. Because I want to see what God is going to do to match our faith. Amen? Would you stand as we close this morning? We're going to sing a song as we close, if we can do that. I said to a friend of mine once, I feel like I'm jipping you if I let you out early. You didn't get what you came for. And she said, trust me, you're not jipping us. It's okay that we're going to get out early. So we're going to sing a song, and then we're going to close in prayer. But I want you to sing this song focused on, name of the song is 10,000 Reasons. And part of that song is 10,000 reasons why we should honor God, why we should trust God. Sing that song believing, whatever you're believing for that seems impossible for you today. Are you being obedient to God's word? Are you stepping out in faith where God tells you to step out in faith? Are you being faithful with your time, your talents, and everything else? Once we do that, God promises to meet us and do that impossible thing. Amen? Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holiness. Go to it. worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name.
The Bible says that God's mercies are new every morning. That means every morning is an opportunity for us to start something new, to make the first step into becoming what we really know God is calling us to. Every morning we have that opportunity. Every day is a new start for us. Israelites had sinned big time all over those years, but at this point the entire nation was making a new start. And God at that point was promising to bless them again. Maybe you're here this morning and you realize you're in a place in your life where you actually do need a new start. You want to forget all the stuff that's behind you, and you want to make a commitment that this is the day I'm going to start from this day forward. I'm going to start doing what God's Word says, believing what God's Word says, and then stepping out in faith, trusting that God will be faithful to His promise. Maybe you're here this morning, you've never really trusted Christ as your Savior. You've never come to the point where you said, "Yes, Jesus, I believe that You died for me. You took my place so that I now may have a relationship with my Father." If that's you, and you want that relationship, I want you to raise your hand right now. Maybe you're that person that wants that new start. You've been following Christ, but you know you're not where you need to be. And you want to make that new start right now. Without anyone looking, everyone's eyes are closed. I want you to raise your hand right now. That's a commitment, that's a promise you made before God. The Bible says, "Forgetting what is behind, I press on." So up until 11:45 Sunday morning, everything prior to this is gone. You're going to make a commitment from this point forward to really getting into God's Word, doing what God's Word says to do, and trust me, I promise that you will see God's hand in your life. It may not be everything you want at that moment, but it will be everything that is best for you at that moment. And you will receive blessing. You will receive God's presence. Father, thank you so much that you give us a new start, that your mercies are in fact new every morning. And that no matter how many times we sin or blown it, you always give us a chance to start new. Lord, I pray for each person here that, God, you would help us to realize how much you love us and care for us, and how much your grace extends to us. For every day, we have the ability to start new. That you keep pursuing us, you keep drawing us in, you keep bringing us back, because you love us more than we can understand. I pray your blessings upon each person here this morning. Allow each one of us to receive exactly what your Holy Spirit has for us. Your Word says that we are to be continually filled with your Spirit. And I pray that you would do that this morning. Fill us with your Spirit that allows us to exhibit the fruit of the Spirit. And that, Lord, as we do that and we see the change and transformation in our life, we will look back and realize that that was God making that change in us. Changes that we were unable to do in ourselves, the Holy Spirit does through us. Father, we love you this morning, And we are so grateful to you for your goodness, your mercy, your faithfulness. I pray that you'd bless each person this morning. Allow them to really experience you on a personal level in their prayer life, in their devotional life, through worship. Allow each one of us to leave a little bit differently because, not because we sang a song, but because we've been in the presence of God. Lord, give us a safe week. Allow us to return next week again to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Father, we ask all this in Jesus' name. All of God's people said, amen. 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 Have a tremendous week. Let me know what God is doing in your life as a testimony and encourages others to have faith.